Good morning, everyone. So today we are going to have international webinar on Fortran Magnum coupled hybrid quantum system for next generation information processing technology. So for this, we have with us the resource person, Dr. Vishwanath Bhoi, postdoctoral resource scholar from National University. Seoul National University, Seoul, Republic of Korea. Now I request our respected principal, Indian Academy Degree College Autonomous, to introduce the resource person and guests and participants for our international webinar. Over to you, sir.
Dear Dr. Vishwanath Bhoi, the resource person for this international webinar, research scholars, members of the faculties from various colleges, and my dear student participants. At the outset, I extend a very warm welcome and good morning to each one of you on behalf of the Indian Academy Degree College Autonomous, the management, the principal and the staff and the students. It is an honor to have you, my dear participants, with us this morning to attend on a topic which is very, very relevant and much advanced and ahead of the present situation. Next generation information processing technology. To share his experience, rich knowledge, and practical research outcomes with us is Dr. Vishwanath. Before introducing him to the audience, I would like to welcome the management of Indian Academy Degree College, our chairman, Dr. Somshekhar, the COO, the heads of the departments, and particularly the faculty members of the Department of Physics, and you, my dear students, research scholars, and teaching fraternity in the field of physics. It was very kind of you that you have responded to our invitation to participate in this international webinar, which I'm sure will enrich your knowledge and give you much information on a topic which is, as I said, very, very advanced and relevant. The resource person, as I said, is all the way from Republic of Korea, Seoul National University. He is a very dynamic, young, and energetic postdoctoral research scholar. Certainly, sir, it is an honor to have you with us this morning and share your in-depth knowledge in an advanced field of physics. The topic might sound very, very strange to many of us who may not be well-versed, photon, magnon, coupled hybrid quantum system. Dr. Vishwanath, having completed his master's in physics from NIT Rourkela, Orissa, moved to IIT of Garakpur to complete his M.Tech in physics, specializing in solid state technology. Later on, he moved to IIT Bombay, presently known as Mumbai, and spent almost 5 full years concentrating and completing, dedicating his knowledge, thought process to a topic called growth and characterization of YIG-based thin films of metamaterials applications. To his credit, both from his M.Tech and IIT PhD. He has published almost 23 outstanding scientific research scholarly papers in reputed national and international journals. In addition to this research publication, Dr. Biswanath has been an author of 18 books, authoring chapters on various topics related to photon-magnon coupling, magnetism, nanomaterials, influence of synthesis process of microstructure and magnetic properties, and so on. Therefore, I don't think we could get any better person than Dr. Biswanath to share his research interests in the field of magnetic thin film, nanoparticles, spintronics, spin dynamics, photon-magnon coupling. Dr. Biswanath has solid work experience in addition to his research. He has been teaching in the Department of Material Science and Engineering at South Korea. He has also carried out his duties on research and development of hybrid structure for photon-magnon N-coupling and spin wave-based device applications. Dr. Biswanath Boy, it is certainly an honor to our institution to have you all the way from South Korea and share your thoughts, particularly knowledge and rich experience that you have in this research area to the research scholars, students, and teaching fraternity. Once again, on behalf of the institution, I extend a most hearty welcome, and I am sure the participants will be delighted to listen to you and inculcate that research interest in the area which is very, very vital today. Over to you, Dr. Biswanath.
Okay, so can I start? I'm audible?
Yes, doctor, you can start.
Okay. So thank you for this nice introduction. So first, I would like to thank the organizing committee for inviting me to deliver the talk. And it's an honor for me also to present my research work or my research experience in front of brightest mind of India. So now I'll going to start my presentations, and now I'll going to share my presentation file. So I'll share the screen now. This is all the possible participants. Okay, how to say? Just a minute. Okay. Thank you. Now we can. Okay. So now we can start. So this is the title of my presentation, Photon-Magnon Coupled Hybrid Quantum System for Next Generation Information Processing Technology. So first I will like to introduce about my lab members. So this is the map of Asia, this is India, and this is a small country, South Korea. We can enlarge it, and we can see this is the capital of Seoul, South Korea. And here our university is located. This is the front gate of our university. And it is a very well-known university having world ranking around 34. And this is my lab members. This is Professor Sang-woo Kim, our head of the group. And it's me, and it is Bo-sung Kim, the PhD scholar who is working with me. So let's start. This is the outline of my talk. First, I'll give a brief introduction about the information, the current information processing technology, and how the study of photon-magnon coupling can be a prospective for the next generation information processing. So I'll give a background of this work, like for what is photon, what is magnons, and how we can excite photon and magnons. Then I'll present my experimental results. So it's a three parts. Here, basically, I'll explain like how we can interact, we can be able to interact a photon with a magnon, and how we can measure the interaction, what is the signature of the interaction, and how we can control the interaction between photon and magnon, and what is the physics behind their interaction. So these are the things I am going to talk. So finally, I'll summarize my work, and I'll give also perspective of the study. So let's start. So nowadays, what we are living, this is the era of third industrial revolution, that is the information technology. So in this era, with the revolution in the information technology, our life become more comfortable. You can start from your smartphone to up to aeroplane, even the traffic signal, everything is controlled by this computation, this information technology. So if we think how it is control, that is basically work on the classical computers. So we have the inputs, the like your PDF file, Word file, or any audio or video files. All these inputs have been encoded in the form of binary digits. These inputs which processed by the logic gates, the logic operation, there are 7 logic gates. So there can be multiple combination of this. And in these logic gates, the basic component is the transistors. So these logic gates are present in this chip, and the transistor is the main that is do the all these basic calculations that is used by these logic gates. So to increase this computer speed, like you can imagine, like before 10 years and now you can compare now how the speed of the computers have been increased. So how it is possible? So it is basically the advancement in the nanotechnology and the lithography techniques. So it is like in the chip, if the number of logic operations you can increase, that means the number of transistors you can increase, that it will make your computer faster. So due to the advancement in the nanotechnology, every year the transistor size has been reduced. That means the number of transistor per chip has been increased. That means that you can increase the logic operations that will make your make the computer faster. But that if you think that can it can be done indefinitely, no, it is not possible. Because if you see this graph with the increase by year by year, you can see the transistor is size is reduced, and by 2030 it can reach to the diameter of hydrogen atom. It's impossible. That means up to certain size we can increase our processing speed, but after that what will happen? Like we are heading towards fourth industrial revolution, where everybody wants a very ultra fast and ultra high capacity information devices. At the same time, the device should be very compact and should be very small. So how we can meet the next generation information processing technology? This is what my research is all about. We can propose an alternative for the next generation technology. Now let's first summarize what I told. So this is the speed and the size of the devices. You can see this is the past and this is the present day electronics, which is based on the charge of the electronics. So if you see the speed and the size, and we can reach up to 1 gigahertz speed, but above that we cannot go. And so some research has focused on the photonics, that photonics that it has the higher speed. So it can solve the purpose, but the size of the photonic that channel or devices cannot be reduced very much, because below certain size, the light has the diffraction, it will diffract it, that photons will lose its information. So what we are proposing here, this area, this magnon and photonics, what we are going to do, instead of charge of the electron, we'll use the spin of the electron, that is already the known area is spintronics. So another is the photon speed. So what we are going to do, we will take the advantages of individual systems like the magnons, that is called as the quanta of spin up, and the photons, which is known as the quantum of electromagnetic wave, which I'll discuss later in detail, like how we can excite these particles. So these magnums have the capability, it can propagate to nano channels, which the normal the charge of the electron cannot do. And the photons, that is the speed of the speed of the light. So we are taking the advantages of both the system, and we are going to make a hybrid system so that can be solve the future problem of information technology. So let's see, this is a abstract picture of the concept. This is the photonic channel. There are two photonic channels. This is the magnetic channels. So here come and they can interact with the magnon. And that means the photon can, all the information that can transport to a magnon, that magnon can propagate and carry that information. And the magnon, again, it can interact with the photon and transfer all the informations. And again, then the information can be detected. So in this case, as a physicist, the first criteria of what we want to look like, how a photon and magnon can interact. And what is the criteria and how we can identify, okay, the interaction has happened. And how, what is the criteria, how we can quantify the interaction? Because if we can understand the interaction and the what is the quantification of the interaction, then we can know, okay, how much energy, how much energy or how much information it can transfer. So these are the things first we are focused, first we have to show the interaction in a very simple device in the laboratory scale. So we made a first, we require a effective coupled system. Also the interaction we are quantifying as a coupling strength. Also we require a high coupling strength. That means higher information can be exchanged. Then we have to see what are the characteristics feature and how we can control this interaction. And the first thing, it should be realized at the room temperature. So these are the criteria of what we are working on this field. So let's start with some background of photon and magnon. So because there are many students are from undergraduate, so I thought I should make a background on this topic. So the photon, that is the quanta of electromagnetic wave. This is the person Einstein who first introduced this term photon in his photoelectric effect. So these are all other scientists like Young, Maxwell, and Planck. You might have heard about their Young's double slit experiment, Maxwell's electromagnetism theory, and the Planck's the quantization of energy. So these are the, they have given the what is called the groundbreaking theories in the field of light. So light is, this is the photons, it is the electromagnetic wave. It has the both electric and magnetic components. So the photon carries all the frequencies starting from radio wave to gamma ray. So our eye is only visible, can only detect or can see in the visible frequency range. Other frequency range are invisible to us. And depending upon the frequency range, the excitation and detection of these photons is always different. They have different kind of devices for different frequencies. So what we are interested basically in the microwave frequency range, because all these devices, that electronic devices are working, like your mobile and all other things, in the this microwave frequency range. So we are focusing on the microwave frequency range. Let's start how we can excite a microwave photons in a laboratory. Here it is the all of you know that antennas are usually used to excite the photons and to detect the photons, so microwave photons. So in the laboratory scale, people usually use this cavities, which is known as microwave cavity resonators. So it can be a cylindrical shape, it can be a rectangular shape. You can see some of the pictures. And when you send a signal of microwave frequency, you can see the distribution of electric field and the magnetic field. You can see some of the people have already published and they have shown how the field distribution is there inside the cavity. And for an example, for a rectangular cavity, this is the formula you can use if you want a desired frequency of that cavity. So you can change the parameter and you can get the frequency, which frequency you require. So you can set the parameters and which mode also you want. So like that, so you can make your own this microwave resonator by your own self for your study. So, but what we are interested in a planar resonator, because we want the application point of view, 3D is always difficult. You cannot embed it in any structures. any devices. So you want a very planar structure. For that, we are going to use a split ring resonator structures. So this is the structure first. It was used to demonstrate the metamaterials. So we are going to use this structure. So it is basically a conducting ring with a split gap. So this conducting ring act as an inductor, and this gap will act as a capacitor. So when it will give a microwave signal of certain frequency, so this rings will be excited. You can see this, the electric field and the magnetic field. And it's basically, I already told it's an inductor and capacitor. So it basically a LC oscillator, and its frequency is root over of LC. So this inductance and the capacitance, it basically depends upon the dimension of this split ring resonator. With the split ring resonator, that we can say SRR further, it can be of any size. You can have hexagon, you can have circle, you have a square like this. And also the complementary structure can also be fabricated. Like if you have a dielectric over which you have the SRR. So in the opposite case, on a conducting plane, you can have a dielectric. This is, you can say, complementary split ring resonator or inverted pattern of split ring resonator. I usually use the term ISRR for this. And because it's a complementary structure, the distribution of the magnetic field and the charges are also complementary. It is the opposite of it. Like this truss and this dot symbol, it shows the direction of the magnetic field, and this is the charge, positive negative charges. And here also this opposite, how it distributed. This is a very simple structure to excite the microwave photon at a laboratory scale. But another thing, in the planar structure, to excite this, we need a microstrip line where we can send the signal. So I'll show next. Let's see. So this is a picture of the microstrip line what we fabricated in our lab. So it is a three layer structure. First is the ground plane. Then you see it is a middle is a dielectric one. This is a conducting line, which is called the microstrip line. So you can see the fabricated front and back side. So this white one is the dielectric. When it is fabricated, this is the copper line, and this is the back of this dielectric, you can see easily. Then this is when you fabricate ISRR in the ground plane. You can see how it is fabricated. And this is the ISRR in the ground plane. This is fabricated in our lab. We can see the pictures. Then you can see how it excites the ISRR. So now it is, the two ports are connected to a vector network analyzer. It usually gives a AC signal of some microwave frequency. So when the signal, it will pass through this microstrip line, you can see it creates electric and magnetic field. So the distribution of the electric magnetic field is the electric field. So as it is a middle one is a dielectric, when for the AC signal like positive or negative half, you can see for the just point, this is one case, you can see the positive charges are here. The negative charges will be concentrated on the ground plane. So in the negative half cycle of the AC signal, it's the opposite. So in this way, the charge will be distributed in the upper and microstrip line on the ground plane. Now, similarly, when we put ISR in the backside of the ground plane, we can see the distribution of charge in and how it is excited the ISRR. So when it is ISR excited, so the resonance frequency, it will be detected also by this vector network analyzer. You can see this kind of absorption peak. From here also, you can find the losses. What are the losses in this ISRR? Using this formula, which is the delta F is the full width of maxima and the resonance frequency position, you can calculate the what are the losses. Basically, this term is also popularly known as the damping parameter. Now let's go to the magnon. So it is like when you apply a magnetic field to a magnet, so ferromagnets, it will magnetize. So you can, it will create a north and south pole. It is a magnetic field lines that is coming from the north to south pole. And if you go to the microscopic scale, you can see is the atomic magnet. So atoms have the magnetic movement that is aligned along the direction of the magnetic field. And this magnetic movement, it's basically arise from that electron is revolving around the nucleus, and the electron also have a spin. So it is the spin angular momentum and the orbital angular momentum of the electron that usually give the magnetization to this atomic magnet and finally to this bulk magnet. Now let's consider the single spin. So when the single spin will perturb with a AC magnetic field, so the spin, the electron will precesses around the direction, around the magnetic field direction, effective magnetic field direction. So the equation of motion you can write in this way. So this is known as the Larmor precession. That means as a function of time, you can see the how the magnetization changes, and you can get the it can describe, you know, the magnetization of this electron. But in a system, like if a system have zero damping, there will be no losses. The electron will continuously precesses, and is the precession. But every system has a damping. Damping means it's something which stop the precession. It allows, it will allow the electrons to spiral, and it can align along the direction of the field. So this is, we can see how it drag is try to drag the electron. So this term is known as the damping. So this is the famous equation, LLG equation, Landau-Lipschitz-Hilbert equation, that basically describe the motion of a, that is, you know, the spin motion of the electron in a system. Now consider a lattice where we have a collective excitation of spins. Now we have more number of spins in a lattice. So it is basically known as the spin wave, the collective excitation of spin structure in a crystal lattice. So if all the spins are precesses with the same phase, that means the way that the spin wave, we can say it is a, it have a zero, it has a zero wave vector, that is ferromagnetic resonance. But if the neighboring spin have a phase difference, you can see different kind of spin waves will be excited. We can say it as a non-zero wave vector. So this is a picture of the spin wave, how it is propagated in a crystal. So there has been many applications of this spin wave, which has already been predicted. So you can see this is the spin wave. You can divide the spin wave into two nano channels. And this you can see the speed of the spin wave. It's very fast. And these are the one example of logic gate, logic operation using spin wave, where this on and on set like one and zero bit. And this is a spin wave filters, like, you know, when in the application of some microwave signals, you require some certain signal at certain frequency. Other frequencies need to be filtered. So this is a filter application of spin wave, where spin wave act as a filter and filter the frequencies, and certain frequencies are propagating and certain frequencies are stopped. So this is, has already been predicted, the application of the spin waves. So like in crystals, like the lattice vibration is known as the quantize, is known as the phonons. Like electromagnetic wave, the quantized term known as the photon. Similarly, in spin wave, the quantized spin waves known as the magnons. So on the name also, one research field is that the magnonics also. So let's understand how we can measure the frequency of this spin wave or the magnons that is excited in a thin plane. So here it is a microstrip line that I already explained how it is, the field has distributed electric and magnetic fields. So you can apply DC magnetic field, it will magnetize the your magnetic material, and you can have the AC signal. When the AC signal will pass through this microstrip line, the AC magnetic field will excite the spin. So the spin precesses, and you can see when the spin's precession it matches with the frequency of this AC signal, it will show some absorption peak. You can find this kind of absorption peak. So this, the peak is known as the resonance frequency, and the full width of maxima, it is the position. So you can, as a particular magnetic field, DC magnetic field, you have a particular resonance frequency. Like that, if you change the magnetic field, vary the magnetic field, you have many spectra, and accordingly you have different resonance frequencies. So this is the famous Kittel's equation. If you fit this spectra with this equation, we can know, we can get the magnetization value. And if you plot the delta as the line width and as function of frequency, and we fit it, and you can say, you can get the value of damping constant, this alpha g is known as Dilbert damping constant. And this delta zero is losses due to the impurity in the sample. So for a plus application point of view, this damping constant should be very less so that the spin wave can propagate longer distance. But if you have a non-zero leak vector k0, then you will get only single resonance peak. But if you have also other spin wave modes like with k0, there will have k other spin wave vectors other than k0, you can get multiple resonance peak. So it is here I have shown a derivative of the signal, because this peaks will, the intensity will be very low. It cannot be detected, it cannot be seen. So if you show the derivative, you can easily get the resonance peak. So if you take the resonance peak like that, it is also a particular magnetic field. If you take the spectra at another magnetic field, you will get some another spectra with a change in the position of the frequency. So for each peak also, you can get similar kind of spectra like this line. One kind of parallel lines. So next, go to some experimental result. Like this is the our own result. So as I showed, it will have some absorption spectra. So this is taken at different magnetic field. So this is the material that is yttrium iron garnet. You can see this is the king of the material in the field of magnetics. So this is the material, this is the best material that can be used for the spin tuning devices that are work in the microwave frequency range, because it has the very low damping. So from this spectra, we can calculate the magnetization value like this fitting with the Kittel's law, and also you can get the damping value. What is the damping of this field? So now it is some, I have given some basics of this magnets. So then, okay, it's another thing is, depending upon the direction of the DC magnetic field, like here the AC signal you are giving, the DC magnetic field direction and the wave vector, there are different kind of spin wave also be excited. So those are known as backward volume magnetostatic wave and magnetostatic surface wave and the forward volume magnetostatic waves. So depending on the direction of the field also, different kind of waves can be excited. So now go to our experimental result. So first, let's realize how we can combine a photon and a magnon mode in the laboratory. So this is the first hybridizing ferromagnetic magnons to microwave photons. So that's already the geometry I have shown. This is the OH film directly you can keep over this microstrip line. So this is the sample. This is the sample structure or device structure. So you can see here, this is the film. The ISRR is in the ground plane. You can apply a magnetic field along this direction and the AC signal along this microstrip line. So in the AC signal have this, of the electric and magnetic field component, you can see the electric and magnetic field distribution. And this electric field, as I said, it can excite the ISRR photons. You can see the excitation, how it is kind of oscillations you can see. And this micromagnetic field, AC magnetic field, it excites the magnon. So simultaneously, in this device, you can excite the photons and excite the magnons. So we can see, let's study it individually. First, take only ISRR and do the measurement. Then take the YIG and do the measurement. And then the ISRR and YIG hybrid structure, combine those and we'll do the measurement. For the ISRR, we can see it is independent upon the DC magnetic field. You can plot it, the magnetic field and the frequency is almost constant. But for YIG, it's strongly dependent upon the magnetic field. If you plot it as a function of magnetic field, you can see the resonance frequencies going gradually increasing. For the hybrid system, when we'll combine it, we can see two modes initially, and this with the increase in magnetic field, this magnon mode approaches to the photon mode, and you can see the gradual increase in their intensity. And when it passes this photon mode, the intensity will decrease. That means you can easily understand it gets some energy from this photon mode. There is some interaction is there. So if you plot it, the dispersion spectra as a function magnetic field, you can see some kind of repelling, some anti-crossing behavior. This is a very, we can say the signature when two quantum systems interact with each other. So let's understand this. This is a photon mode. This is independent upon the magnetic field, this magnetic field. This is the wave vector k0 we have taken because there is no spin wave, other modes are there, single spectra is there. So we can say it is strongly dependent upon the magnetic field, but when it will combine, it shows some anti-crossing behavior. This is what I told, the signature of the photon magnon coupling. So let's try to understand this. To understand this, first we can use a simple classical coupled oscillator model, where one oscillator is a photon, another oscillator is a magnon, and they have a coupling constant K, and they have the resonance frequency. This is the resonance frequency of the magnon mode, the Kittel's law, the Kittel's equation, and this is the LC oscillation equation of the photon. So let's, to understand this, let's see this oscillation of both the modes. This, when this oscillator, when is far from this far from this mode, and when it can gradually come near to this mode, you can see there is a increase in the amplitude. At the same time, there is a decrease in the amplitude of this mode. And when this mode passes, you can see it's again regains its amplitude. That means the interaction, they have the exchange of energy between these two modes. And we can write the equation of motion for these two oscillators. And by solving this oscillator, we can get a frequency, hybrid frequency mode for this coupled oscillator. So I'll just explain this next slide. See, this term in this equation is known as the coupling strength. And this F1, A plus and minus is the upper branch of the frequency, another is the lower branch of the frequency. If two system does not couple, we'll see both will cross each other. But when they have a coupling, we can see the how the modes are anti-crossing with each other. So by fitting this equation, we can get the coupling strength. This is the no coupling, and when this the coupling is there. So this is the G effective by 2 pi, this term, it's give the coupling strength of the, when the hybrid system is there. So if the splitting between the two mode is higher, that means the interaction is strong, the coupling is strong, more energy can be exchanged. Energy means in this case, we can say the information can be exchanged between the two mode. So you can see easily here, this is when there is no coupling, and when the coupling strength is 90 megahertz, and if you increase the coupling strength, you can see how this anti-crossing behavior is changing. So again, we want to study, let's how we can control this coupling strength. So as we already told that by changing the direction of the magnetic field, different kind of spin waves can be excited. So you can see this is the coupled mode, and if there is only one photon, only the one magnon mode, one photon mode, you can see this kind of behavior. But at the, when you change the angle, you can see many modes are coming out. So for each angle, when we change the direction of the magnetic field, we have also fitted the oscillator model, and we also calculated the coupling strength, and we found there is a, we can manipulate the coupling strength, the interaction between the photon and magnon, by changing the direction of the magnetic field. So we then next we further interested to study these spin wave modes in more detail. So let's study this excitation of spin wave mode and some of the critical angle. I'll just, this previous slide you can see. So this is the critical angle what we say, because other modes, there have been spin wave modes are there, but at certain angle the spin wave modes will disappear. So it's called its critical angle. So let's usually in the next study we just go into deep to identify the critical angle, and some will give some mathematics for this. As already I showed this slide, that depending upon the direction of the magnetic field, different kind of spin waves or the magnon modes can be excited. So then we made a rotatable magnet that we can change the direction of the magnetic field at any arbitrary direction. So first, what we did for this particular, these three angles, we measured the photon-magnon coupling. We can see the spectra. This is previous spectra of what I showed. It's a two-dimensional figure. It's a 3D figure. So you can see how the spin wave modes are there. You can see for each cases, the spin wave modes are there. The significance of this mode is like each mode carries some amount of information. Like when you have multiple signal processing, that means at a single magnetic field, if you want to give an input of multiple signal, in this case, this spin wave modes has the advantages over the other kind of signal processing, because it can provide a multiple signal at a single magnetic field. So this is, you can see for the particular three magnetic field directions. Then you can see for all the arbitrary direction we have performed. This is a two-dimensional figure. So these are the angles we have mentioned from 0 to 90 degree. We have measured this photon magnon coupling. And then what we did, this figure, you can just enlarge this to explain this mode. So this is the photon mode and this is the magnon mode. You can see this is the FMR mode, which k is equal to 0. And these are the different modes. They have the different wave vectors. So this is the what I previously told about the Kittel's equation. This is a more generalized equation which can give the, you can predict the frequency of different modes. So like that, if for the Kittel mode, the wave vector is 0, k is equal to 0. So if you put k is equal to 0, this equation directly will be give the Kittel's equation. So by using this equation, you can identify each of these modes. And we have plotted here the wave vector versus the frequency. The solid line is the analytical, the theoretical curve. And these are our experimental data, which we estimated from the experimental data. And it is exactly matching with that mode. And then we plot this different wave vector we have taken. And as a function of angle, we have calculated their frequency. And we found that first, the experiment we have observed some critical angle at which there will be only single mode. That means all this wave vector has been merged to a single mode. Here, all the modes have a single frequency, or the resonance frequency is same. So for three different angles, we can see for these cases, we have some critical angle. Here, we have some critical angle. For these cases, there is no critical angle, but because by increasing the field, there is so demagnetizing field will be go on increasing. So we cannot see some critical angle in these cases. So mathematically, we can predict this. So this is the frequency equation. That means if all have the single frequency is constant for all the wave vectors, then if we do the derivative, it should be 0. So we can say it's a group velocity. The frequency, we can do the derivative and we can get, and it will be 0. And if you get to 0 and solve it, we can get the expression for the critical angle. So this is the critical angle expression that we have derived. And based on this critical angle, we have also predicted a phase diagram between the different kind of spin wave modes. So you have the forward whirling mode, you have the magnetostatic modes, and the backward whirling mode. All are the magnon modes. So these are the angles and where, and this at a particular field. If you change the field, if you change the magnetic field, only the frequency position will change, but the figure will be the same. So this is the critical angle at which only FMR mode, wave vector k will be x0 will be excited, and here other spin wave modes can be excited. So depending upon someone's requirement, which kind of spin wave modes he can use and he can excite, it can be give a, this phase diagram give a direction how we can excite certain kind of spin wave modes and it can be used for the study of the magnetics or the spin waves. Next, we want to understand how it happens, how what is the mechanism that two photon and magnon modes interact with each other. So what we understand from this, there are two classical mechanisms, that is the Faraday's laws of induction and Rampier's law, which playing the role in the interaction between the magnon and photon mode. So let's understand this. So when the microwave signal will pass this in the microstrip line, it simultaneously excites the magnons here and also photons here. So when the photons are excited, it creates a strong magnetic field here at this gap. This magnetic field also affects the magnetization this here. So this is the Ampere's law. The creative magnetic field, it excites the magnetization also here. Initially, it has also the dynamic magnetization. It also introduces another dynamic field. So similarly, the change in magnetization in this case induces a voltage based on the Faraday's laws of induction. So it can induce a voltage in the ISR photon mode. So it is a very instantaneous and a very simultaneous process. So the main thing is this, the two micromagnetic fields that are affecting the both ISR and photon. So we have taken the field, like one field is coming from the ISR another field is coming from this microstrip line. So we have defined like delta is the ratio of the strength of the micromagnetic field and the phase difference between these two. So by considering the all the interaction, then we have solved the Maxwell equation and the LLG equation. That I skip all this mathematics and just I'm giving the coupling matrix equation. So you can easily understand this one. So this is the resonance. This equation gives the resonance frequency of the ISR resonance, the photon resonance. This equation only in this matrix, it will give the YIG resonance. This candidate here, it will give the effect of change in magnetization. That means the change in magnetization, how it induces the voltage in the ISR spectra. So this term is the effect of the ISR magnetic field on the YIG magnetization. So this is the coupling spectra, coupling matrix. So we can solve it with some assumption, like if the two systems are very low damping, this is alpha that already I have been discussed, beta is the damping of photon mode, alpha is the damping of magnon mode. If you assume it is very, very less, whereas with this assumption, we can solve it and we can get expression for this coupling strength, the energy or the frequency. So in this case, we can see these two terms is the delta and phi. So it must affect the their resonance frequency or the coupling strength. So then we thought, okay, is it possible to change this delta and phi? So what we thought, if we'll, when we do the numerical simulations, we found if we'll change the direction of the split gap, we can easily see there is a direct change in the direction of the current, and also you can see the phase difference between their spectra. That means if there is a 180 phase difference between the two spectra, that means there must be a, that must affect their magnetic field. So there must be a pi difference in their micromagnetic field. So what we did, we made two different samples, like with a sample with split gap and this side, and the split gap along this side with respect to the microstrip line. So we individually measure for two different samples, for this sample and this sample, we use case one and case two. And we see for this case, we will see the normal anti-crossing where two modes will repel each other. But in case of case two, we found some opposite kind of behavior. Actually, this behavior was very strange for us when we measure this, when we get the signal. And then we fitted with our theoretical data and we observed that it fitted well. But for the normal anti-crossing case, we get a real value of coupling strength. For this opposite anti-crossing, we get an imaginary coupling strength. And it is difficult to realize how a coupling strength can be imaginary. So after this work, it published, there are many work has published related to this work, and they have demonstrated this kind of behavior. Still, and this is under investigation for more detail, why it is happening and what is the mechanism for this. And recently it was predicted that when a system, two system interacting, and this they can have this kind of behavior, they can, they have a application in the field of unidirectional energy transfer. That means energy can transfer in a single direction. There won't be any backflow of energy. So still it is going on, this study is going on this topic. So then what we did, we further change the value of delta and phi. Then we want to study, okay, how this delta and phi affect the interaction between the photon and magnon mode. First, we fix the delta is equal to zero. That means the field that is coming from the ISR photon mode is much less than the microstrip line. In this case, it does not affect the interaction, but it can show all the in for different value of pi. This pi is the phase difference between these two modes. The signal, the interaction is same. It does not affect. But when we make the thing, the, when the field is coming from the ISR and field is coming from the strip line is same, and when we change the phase difference, phase between these two field, we can see it's a very it's a very significant effect on the interaction. And we can see at this curve, we can see when the fields are coming from both the ISR and microstrip line, it's same, and they are out of phase. Means there is a phase difference by both the field cancel each other. There will be no magnon modes, only photon mode exist here. So then when we next case, when we put delta is equal to 2, that means when this field strength, this field is coming from the ISR much higher than the field of the microstrip line, in this case when we change the phase difference between the two field, you can see this spectra, this interaction can go from a normal anticrusting to opposite anticrusting. This significance of this spectra is that by playing with delta and phi, by controlling delta and phi, you can control the interaction. So you can control the flow of energy from one system to other system, and whether you want the energy that should be exchanged in the both the direction or a single direction, you can control. So when, as I told, when we are controlling the energy exchange between the two modes, that means we are controlling the information that can go from one mode to other mode, one mode to other mode. So based on this work, we plotted a phase diagram. You can see this is normal anticrusting region, this opposite anticrusting region. This is the boundary between the normal opposite anticrusting region. So this corresponds to the ideal case when the system have a very low damping. But in reality, always the system have a damping, always your photon and magnon mode, because this is a lab med, you always have a damping in that. So then this damping must be included into the equation. Then we made a new equation, derived a new equation, and we separate the parameters, this delta and phi, that's a geometry parameter, is depending upon the orientation of the ISRR. And these are the intrinsic parameter, beta and alpha and the coupling strength. So depending upon this value, it can go from a normal anticrusting to opposite anticrusting. That means if this value is higher, delta geometry, it will have a normal anticrusting. If this value is higher, it will have a imaginary coupling strength. That means it will have a opposite kind of anticrusting. When both modes are same, there will be no anticrusting. And that will be the boundary between the two normal anticrusting. And this, based on our experimental data, this corresponds to the boundary line. The red line corresponds to the boundary line between the normal anticrusting and opposite anticrusting. So this is the all of the work that we did in this area. So just I'll summarize my work. This is the first, we predicted the photon magnon coupling and its signature using a planar devices. Although you can imagine this is a device in the millimeter scale, but this is the, what is the, this research field is in the preliminary stage. On this, based on the understanding of the concept, we can make a device of the nanoscale or some, first we can go for a micrometer scale, then we can go for nanometer scale. The physics will remain be the same. So first, to understand the physics, we made a millimeter scale devices. Then here in a second study, we have excited the different kind of spin wave modes that I mentioned. It has the application when we are going to use for the multiple signal processing. So here it, we have predicted the abnormal anticrusting, which is related to the unidirectional energy flow. That means we can control the energy flow from both direction or single direction. So I'll give an outlook of this study and the significance in these two slides. So this is recently the different kind of research field that emerged just 1 year before based on this photon magnon coupling. That is the cavity spintronics. People have started measuring the spin current during this photon magnon coupling, though the new field emerged, cavity spintronics. So here in this, it is known as cavity optomagnonics, where they can combine the optical photons with the microwave photons through photon magnon coupling. So this is a new field, and this is the what I previously that mentioned, the lattice vibration phonon. The phonon mode can also be coupled with this photon mode through photon magnon coupling. That's a cavity magnon mechanics. And this one, superconducting qubits, that is specially designed for the quantum computers. It can also interact with the photons. And this this photon magnon coupling has a direct relevance with this quantum computation. Just one slide I'll briefly explain. In quantum computers, like in classical computers, you have 0 bit and 1 bit. So in quantum computers, people are using the qubits. The qubits can be a photon, can be an electron, and can be atoms or superconducting qubits. So to make a real application, you have all the single qubits need to be interact, and they can make a multi-qubit processor. So, but the qubits, how they'll enter, they need a medium, that is, they require a coupler. So if the magnons can be used as a qubits, photon can be used as a coupler. So this is one of the application of this photon magnon coupling. So now this is the end of my presentation, and thank you all for your kind time, for your attention and listening my talk. So now you can have the questions. I'll try to explain. Thank you. Hello. Can you hear me, Dr. Banita?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm there.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. It was a nice presentation. We are just waiting for the participants to drop their questions if they have doubts, sir. Your topic was little like a higher level for the MS students, sir.
Okay,
yeah. So there are some few faculty members from all over India. There is a question.
Okay.
Is there GMR effect in it, Dr. P.C. Rai?
I'm just explaining. So GMR, it is the giant magnetoresistance. So it usually affect like when you have a multilayer system, like you have a magnetic and non-magnetic layer and multilayer system, or if you have a granular kind of structure, like one metallic and a magnetic there. So it is called the term that is RKK kind of interaction that is give your GMR effect. So here it is an insulator. The YAG is a special insulator. So there won't be any GMR effect, and it is a single film. So there won't be any GMR in this photon magnon coupling. So any other questions? So I have to answer, I have to type the answers.
No need, it's okay.
Okay.
So I have a doubt, this, you have something you mentioned, epitaxial film growth. Epitaxial film growth, like for your YIZ and that one more, how you coupled the both the things?
I understand.
Your laboratory material?
Okay. For making the epitaxial film of YAG, we can, the substrate that is used is GGG, gadolinium gallium garnet. So both have the same structure and have the same lattice parameter. So we can grow this using a PLD, we can grow this film in our lab. And when we couple it, the film side should touch the microstrip line. The substrate side will be in the offside. I have not shown it. So it can easily excite the magnum.
Thank you. Okay, I think there are no questions, sir.
So if there will be any question, they can send in my email.
Definitely. We are ready to send your email to the participants if they have any doubt or they want to contact you.
They can directly send the email and I'll try to answer their questions.
Really, it was a wonderful presentation by you, though it was on a little higher level for us to reach the things. you have done, and you have very prestigious journal publications of your work. Okay, sir. So now, we have come to the end of the webinar by Dr. Vishwanath Bhoi. So now I take this opportunity to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of Indian Academy Degree College Autonomous, Bengaluru, India. So at the outset, I thank the management of Indian Academy Group of Institutions for the support rendered to us in organizing this international webinar. First of all, my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Vishwanath Bhoi, resource person of the today's international webinar. Thank you, sir. And really, your session was very informative, elaborative, and well explained on the topic that is like your hybrid photon magnon hybrid coupled hybrid quantum system for the next generation technology. So, sir, we are really grateful for the time and effort you took to share your knowledge and experience in the field of hybrid quantum system. So, sir, I'm sure that your session would have triggered the mindsets of all UG and PG students, basically for the science background and research scholars, as well as the faculty members of various institutions. Now I thank the Dr. Srinidhi K. Parthasarathy, Chief Operating Officer, Indian Academy Group of Institutions, for his moral support. Now, I would like to thank personally the person who is always with us, who is a man of great motivation and always motivating us for organizing various activities. He is none other than our beloved principal, Dr. E. Jerome Xavier. I thank sir for his valuable guidance and support. I thank all the faculty members of Department of Physics for their help and support.